Hi, Miss Ellen.
Hi, Mr. D.
I just realized this is in the picture. It's okay.
What is it?
It is a piece to a bed.
Uh-huh.
A little piece to a bed over there.
Nice. Yeah,
so we'll just look, look, look. It's gone.
Yeah. Yeah. If I go this way, you see the kitchen back there. But if I go this way, there's so much dark, it doesn't look like I have hair.
It's about getting the camera angle just right here.
It is.
For children's worship time.
I think that we've been very flexible.
We have. Oh,
I could pull you and, if it looks like I'm winking at people this morning, it's because I've got something in my left eye and I can't seem to get it out. So.
I thought maybe there was an inside joke happening there, if you know what I mean.
I do know what you mean.
Not the case, huh?
You know, one of those mornings, Mr. D, where you think you've got your whole act together and then stuff just doesn't seem like it's working?
Sure do. Mr. D woke up early this morning to get a lot done, but...
Uh-huh. Eh. You know, sometimes strange things just sort of happen.
Indeed.
I understand you had some visitors on your porch.
I did. Oh. I saw some narcissies and maybe a friend, and mm-hmm. they dropped off some delicious cookies. I can't say the cookies are still here.
Oh, what happened? Them. Did Sully and Olivia eat them?
Somebody must have came in and eaten them because they are all gone. And oh my goodness, Chef Bright, they were so delicious.
What kind did you get?
I got snickerdoodle.
Oh boy, that's a favorite.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is.
I have some more that I'm going to be delivering probably today to some people. So.
Oh, awesome. Awesome. That's so fun. I love that. I love that you're doing that. All right, well, let's get started with our three chimes.
Okay.
And as always, on that third chime, you can put your hand in the air when you can't hear it anymore. There it goes.
Okay.
And let's sing our call to worship. Be still.
And we do know God's word is here in shared with us in the Bible, whether it's a storybook Bible or a children's translation, or it could be just one of the translations that we use in our sanctuary. There's that huge Bible that we see the acolyte and the beadle carry down, and they put it up on the lectern. Jesus's word is shared. God's word is shared through the Bible, but it's also shared in Jesus the person, who is a real person, not a fictional person. Jesus was a real person who walked on earth just like we do. And we can remember that Jesus was a real person by the light that we shine and show and share at the beginning of our worship service, but also it can be something that you could have at home. You could have your own worship table at home if you chose. You could put anything that you'd like on it. It could be a storybook. It could be a favorite stuffed animal. It could be artwork or flowers. I have flowers here and a Bible and a cross. And we have the green fabric right now because we're still in ordinary time, which doesn't mean things are ordinary. It just means that's the time that we remember the everyday ordinary things that happened in Jesus's life. It wasn't like his birth or the crucifixion. It isn't All Saints Day. It's not Pentecost when the Holy Spirit came. It's ordinary time of Jesus teaching and people learning. Just like sometimes ordinary time for us is just like ordinary time for school. It's just ordinary stuff that we're doing each day, but it doesn't mean it's not important. Our story today comes from the New Testament, and it's actually told in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. But for the 11 o'clock worship service today, the focus is on the story as it's told in the Gospel of Matthew. All three disciples wrote about it, so we know again that it was an important lesson or story. But it's not an easy story to hear. Sometimes Jesus would tell stories. And if you don't know what was up either before he told this parable or story or after, you look at it and you say, is that really something Jesus and God want us to think about? This is one of those, and it's a tricky one. But once we hear a little bit more about it, it makes more sense. So we'll listen for Matthew in our Holy Book song. And because it's from Mark and Luke as well, I mean, if somebody wanted to dance for those three books, they could. I know that Cole likes to dance to the Holy Book song. So Cole, if you're listening today, you can dance to Matthew, Mark, and Luke when we get there.
All right, let's do it.
Second look, this is God's holy word. Tell God's message till all have heard. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges. I'll tell you the truth about the book of Ruth on the first and second Samuel, first and second Kings, first and second Chronicles, and all these things lead to Ezra, Nehemiah, Esther, and Job. I want to go to heaven in a righteous robe, singing Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Solomon's Song, and the prophets are these: Isaiah, Jeremiah, and Jay's Lament, Ezekiel, and Daniel in the lion's den, Hosea, Joel, and Amos's tale, Obadiah, Jonah in the belly of the whale, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk's cry, Testament books reveal that Malachi points to a brand new time. These are the holy books. Tell me their names and take a second look. This is God's holy word. Tell God's message to all have heard. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. The stories of Jesus, and then move on to Acts and the letters of First and Second Corinthians, all Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. Move on to First and Second Thessalonians, First Timothy, Second Timothy, Titus, Philemon, Hebrews, and James. Two books for Peter, and John's all three. Jude the dude in Revelation, you'll see that these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ and his grace received.
Love it. And I see that Andrea and Lily are here, and Maria and Brian. So Maria Doherty is here, and Brian. I saw a picture of Maria and Julia this past week. I can't get over how tall they're getting.
Oh my goodness.
And, you know, it's been, 7 months since we've seen our friends?
Yeah, it's been a really long time.
Yeah, and 7 months is a long time for, you know, changing schools and growing and doing new things. And so we miss our friends, but it's so great we get to share time with them this way, isn't it? I love it. So as I was saying, today's parable is something Jesus told. And here's the deal. Jesus told this story to his disciples, but really, he was pointing this story at some people who were sort of listening behind. They were the Pharisees. Pharisees were the religious leaders of the Jewish church. They weren't necessarily bad people. Sometimes people think Pharisees are bad. They were really, really, really dedicated to their religion and to the Jewish faith. And their job was to kind of make sure that everybody was following the Jewish faith the way they had been taught for generations. And they were worried that Jesus was this person who was starting to teach things that didn't exactly sound like the Jewish faith and the Jewish laws and the Jewish version of God that they'd heard about. So they were kind of freaking out over this Jesus who was teaching things that were a little bit different. So they kind of said to him, hey, Jesus, who said you could talk like this? The Bible says, by whose authority do you get to do this? So it's kind of like, who said that you could talk about God this way? Well, Jesus always does this. Instead of saying, well, God said I could talk this way, and I'm the Son of God, Jesus answers stuff with stories and sometimes with questions. So Jesus decides to tell this story about these people in a vineyard. A vineyard is a garden, a huge farm where grapes are grown. And Jesus tells this story about the vineyard, and we'll show you pictures of what that looks like in a little bit. And he's really telling this story, and people are starting to put the little puzzle pieces together in their head. And they're like, Jesus isn't really talking about a farmer, and Jesus isn't really talking about the people who are farming it. And Jesus isn't really talking about the farmer's son. Maybe the son there that he's referring to is himself, the Son of God. And so Jesus answers the question that the Pharisees had, like, who says you have all this information? Who gave you the right to talk about God this way? By telling a story. And at the end, they're like, ooh, he really thinks that, like, God talked to him and told him to teach this. And the Jewish people were kind of freaked out about it because this went against everything that they kind of learned. Not only that, but the Pharisees right then are like, this man's dangerous and we need to arrest him. But they were afraid of the people who were there around them. And so they said, okay, we're just going to cool our jets for a little bit and continue to watch this Jesus guy. But we're a little concerned about what's going on. Okay. So Mr. D, can you show us some of the pictures of this vineyard before we talk about the specifics of the story? So friends, this is what a vineyard looks like. This one is out in California. And you can see there are lots of rows and rows and rows of grape plants. And the grape plants come up onto trellises or onto fences, and they have to be trimmed and taken care of. And you can go to the next one, Mr. D, whatever one that is, it's fine. This is a vineyard worker. This person has picked grapes in a basket. You can see why you couldn't like drive a tractor down the middle of these rows. It's a very, what they call, labor intensive. It takes a lot of work to do it. And you have to pick all the grapes. There's green grapes and there's red grapes. Probably the grapes that were grown in Jesus's region of the world were the red grapes or purple grapes. Like those, exactly. And look how full those are. So it takes a lot of work to do this. And they didn't have some of the ways we have today to help take care of the plants. They couldn't irrigate them with water. They maybe didn't have things to spray on them to keep a fungus away. So there was a lot of work that went into taking care of grapes. Let's see another one. Oh, I really like this because our parable talks about a watchtower. So this is kind of a watchtower that is in a vineyard. That's where somebody would climb up inside and look. And I think we have another picture of a watchtower too that might be more like what was in Jesus's time. See it? Grapes were really important crops. And so it was very important to make sure that people weren't coming out and kind of stealing the crops. So a watchtower could be where the farmer or another person would stay and watch and make sure nobody was stealing the grapes. It was also a good way to make sure that animals were kept out of the vineyard. So a watchtower is someplace where the farmer or a farmer's worker would stay. Okay, Mr. D, thank you. So in this story, you'll hear that Jesus talks about there's the watchtower, the farmer is watching from there, observing things from there. This story is about when the farmer needed to go away, like on vacation, you know, for a while. And the farmer couldn't just wait until he came back to pick all the grapes or take care of them because you have to tend to the vines. Somebody has to be in the watchtower making sure that everything's safe. So he went out into the community and found people who said, yeah, we'll pay rent to come and work in your vineyard and we'll take some of the grapes as our pay, and we'll leave the rest for you. Very, very fair, because they were going to be doing a lot of the work. And the farmer said, super, we'll have this deal. We'll trade. You can come and work here. I'll be so grateful you're going to work here. But when I come back, I'll get some of the grapes and you get some of the grapes as payment. Jesus tells us in this story, the farmer comes back and sends his servants or his workers out to get the grapes. And the people who were working the farm over the summer or over the vacation were up in that watchtower, and they saw the servants coming and they killed them. That's bad. I mean, that's bad in any way you look at it, it's bad. But they decided, you know what? We've been working in this farm. We're taking everything. We're not sharing it with the farmer. We had a deal to go, we started with, but we're just not going to share. So they killed him. They killed all those people. Well, the farmer was so upset and thought, well, you know what? I'm going to send a few more servants. Maybe they'll realize and that they need to share, and sent more people, and they killed them too. So the last thing the farmer did was thought, well, you know what? I'm going to send my son out there because they've got to respect the landowner's son, the farmer's son. I'm going to send my son out there to collect on this and to say, okay, you're done now farming and I'm home. I'll take care of this. They killed the son. The farmer never figured that would happen. It was absolutely terrible. And then the story ends. Jesus ends the story with that. Well, everybody's looking at him like, what are we supposed to do with this? Like, what is the story about? Like, you're telling us that there's this farmer and there's these people there and they keep killing his servants and then they kill his son. And what is this about? Jesus wanted the Pharisees to hear this story. Jesus wanted the Pharisees to realize that the farmer represents God. The people who were doing the farming when he was gone and who killed off the messengers, like a prophet, those people in the fields were the Pharisees and some of the Jewish people who weren't willing to share and hear new things. And the son of the farmer was Jesus. So Jesus was kind of telling everybody, look, you got to take care of what God gives you. You need to share in the kingdom of God. You've got to share. And you've got to respect God's son. Listen to the prophets. So Jesus went all the way back to the Old Testament and was saying, listen to what the prophets said. Listen to what God is saying and listen to what the son is saying. It's a really, really tricky parable to hear. I like to think of it this way. Think of some time that you ignored a warning way too many times and you finally got in trouble for it. Have you ever done that? Have you ever like been warned, don't do it, don't do it, don't do it, don't do it, and you ignored it and you did it and then you got in trouble for it? That's kind of what's happening here. Jesus is warning the Pharisees. He's warning the Jewish people that God's kingdom's for everybody and we have to share it. It doesn't matter if you're Jewish or if you're a Gentile, which is what they called non-Jews at that time, or Gentiles. It doesn't matter who you are. God's kingdom's for everybody. So I'm warning you, I'm warning you. Please listen to the messages that God's sending you. I'm trying to get this through to your heads, people, is what Jesus was saying. So if you happen to listen to the 11 o'clock service today, Pastor Todd's going to be talking about this parable as well. And the neat thing about sermons is that they can help us today to understand things in our lives today, but they were told thousands of years ago. Jesus lived over 2,000 years ago, and the stories that he told 2,000 years ago still impact us today. Might be different because we don't sit around and talk about Jews and Gentiles now the way they did, or we don't talk about the Pharisees, or probably the average Pittsburgh person is not going to understand the story of a vineyard and a watchtower, but the message is still there. So, Mr. D, I'm guessing that today there's a song or a hymn or something we might want to learn for the service.
There are two hymns. We always have an opening hymn and a closing hymn. And I thought it would be fun to remember one that we've done before. But today, I'm going to go over it, and then I'm going to sing the whole thing. And then I'm going to let you at home sing it without my help. Because we've done this one a couple times, and it's a super, super familiar hymn. So I think you're going to be able to do it. Now, I know you're going to be able to do it. So it is Praise Ye the Lord, the Almighty. And this one, the tune is Lob den Herren. Oops, and I forgot to put the meter in. That might be something that you need to figure out what the meter is, how many syllables are in each line. I'll give you a hint. The first one's 14. That's a lot. But let's remember this all together. How about we just start with the echo thing where you remember it with me? So I'll sing it first and then you can sing it after me. The first line goes like this. Praise ye the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. You try that. Praise ye the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Good. Next line sounds exactly the same. Sounds exactly the same with different words. Here's the next one. Oh, my soul, praise him, for he is thy health and salvation. Your turn. Oh, my soul, praise him, for he is thy health and salvation. Now we're going to bring our voices up high. All ye who hear, now to his temple. Turn. Now to his temple draw near. And then we're going to bring our voices low to high for the last part, which sounds like this. Join me in glad adoration. Your turn. Join me in glad adoration. All right, we reviewed the whole thing. So now it's time. Now it's your turn. I'll sing the whole thing one time, and then I'm just going to play and let you at home sing it the second time. Does that sound like a good idea? I'll make it really big so that we can see all of it. I'll do it the first time, and then you do it the second time. Here's a little introduction, too. Here we go. I'll go first. Praise ye the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. I hope you were able to sing all of that. That's a lot to sing, isn't it? And when we sing that today in worship, I want you to listen for two things. There's two hymns. Remember, I told you there's an opening hymn and a closing hymn. That's the opening hymn. But then when we get to the closing hymn, which is this one, we all are one in mission. And maybe we can get Miss Ellen when she comes back to pronounce that German for us, if she's able to. But when we listen to this one, I want you to listen to how similar the tunes are. They're not the same tune. In fact, they're very different, but they have the same feel and kind of the same melody line, which is really, really interesting. Hey, Miss Ellen, do you want to give it a try?
Yes, give me the, let me see.
All right.
Okay, es flog ein kleines Waldvögelein. It flies like a small bird in the forest.
You're amazing.
Well,
so that was beautiful.
Yeah, it's funny. I studied German for a long time, and there's still a lot of it that sticks in my head. So
that's awesome. That's great how it's able to stay in there, those second languages.
It really is.
Well, and go ahead.
There's just a lot of cool things that we remember in our heads. And that's why, like, some of these stories that, you know, Jesus told and things are just so cool, because you remember them later and you're like, oh, and maybe they mean something different when you get older too. You know, you hear a story, like there's the parable of the Good Samaritan, and you hear it when you're a kid, and then you hear it when you're a teenager, and then you hear it maybe when you have your own children, or you hear it when you get older. And it means something different each time.
It can mean something from different from week to week, depending on how your week went and the things that you're thinking about and doing.
Yeah, it can. Really, it's so cool when stories, and they can mean something different for me versus you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's why, like, when I'm working on telling stories for Sunday school, I use all kinds of books because every one of them has a different way of looking at it. And one of the ones I absolutely love, it's called Shareable Parables. And Stephen James, who wrote this book, he does such a good job of, like, helping. And it has sections that say, like, okay, here's how a 3-year-old might understand this. Here's how a 12-year-old might understand this. I'm looking like, where does it say how a 57-year-old understands it? But I sometimes I think
I don't know any 57-year-olds, so yeah. I don't think we have to worry about that.
Oh, yeah, you might. You just might. Well, friends, we'll do.
Do you want to do birthdays first? I think we have a birthday. I think. Let's take a look and see. Oh, Hudson! Happy birthday, Hudson! Let's sing. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you, and many more.
And I saw where Hudson had a monster truck for his birthday cake.
Cool, that's awesome.
Yeah, isn't that cool? Any kind of cake is good, but I bet you a monster truck birthday cake is pretty delicious.
Yeah.
Looked like it had dirt going down the middle. I hope it wasn't really dirt. Although there's lots of vitamins in that.
Yeah, that's true. Minerals and vitamins for sure. Yeah.
So friends, we have a chance to do our closing prayer, but I wanted to read something to you to help you remember when we, you know, when we change the light and we talk about, like, there's nothing you could do that could stop Jesus from loving you. There's this really cool thing in this kids devotional called Jesus Calling. And I really liked it because I think it helps us understand a little bit more the message that Jesus is telling us when Jesus says, I love you all the time. And this one says, I have loved you, my people, with an everlasting love, with an unfailing love. I have drawn you to myself. That's from Jeremiah. It says, I love you with an everlasting love. It has no beginning and no end, and it never changes. It's impossible for you to completely understand my love, God says. You need to see me and my feelings the same way as you see your own. You kind of do that, but that might not be the right way. Because maybe, God says, my feelings are different than the way you tend to see your feelings. Your feelings change, God says. Friends come and friends go. Anger can make you feel less love for someone, while happiness can make you feel more love for someone. And in the back of your mind, you wonder if I'm that way too, says God. I am not. There is nothing you can do that will change my love for you. If you mess up, I am sad, but I don't love you less. If you do something wonderful for me, I'm happy, but I don't love you more. Love is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And it's bigger and deeper than you could ever imagine. So let me love you always and all ways. God's love never changes for us. So let us pray. Dear God, thank you for loving us. Thank you for loving us on our good days and on our bad days. Thank you for loving us when we remember that you are the reason that we have everything that we have. Thank you for loving us when we forget those things. And thank you for loving us when we remember those things. God, just help us to continue to be our best selves, to work toward telling the love of Jesus to others in the things that we say and in the things that we do and the way we treat others. We pray these things, Lord, in the name of your Son, who taught all of us a special prayer to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Just like we read in our devotion, Jesus loves us all the time. Good days, bad days, when we mess up, we just have to remember to be gracious and to thank Jesus for loving us and to love Jesus back. And I can't find my snuffer, so we're going to change the light using a piece of cardboard and deprive the flame of oxygen very slowly. As it changes, there it goes, there it goes, there it goes. See you next time.